Imagine a world where family visits have to be meticulously scheduled. Holiday traditions are upended and boundaries are the new norm. Millennial daughter-in-laws are rewriting the rules and causing waves in family dynamics. Today, we'll dive deep into why these changes are happening and what they mean for the future of family relationships through the story of Emily and Karen. Picture this. It's a crisp autumn morning in their peaceful suburban neighborhood. Emily, our millennial daughter-in-law, is sitting at her kitchen table. She's sipping on her first cup of coffee, but it's not a relaxing morning. She's got a lot on her mind because she's gearing up for another boundary-setting conversation with her mother-in-law, Karen. For Emily, boundaries are all about her mental health and keeping her sane, and it's not really a choice for her. Let me explain. Emily's childhood, it was filled with unrealistic expectations and conditional love. Her parents were high achievers, they were highly critical, and they expected perfection. And as you can imagine, this led to severe anxiety, panic attacks, and a deep fear for Emily that she was never going to be enough. So to cope, Emily became this serious planner, a little OCD-like. But this is the way she feels like she has some sort of control of her life, which that makes sense. Most of us, when we feel chaos on the inside, we'll pick one or a couple things to control on the outside, our external world. So it could be the family calendar, it could be meal planning, it could be exercise, nutrition, it could be trying to manage other people's relationships. We just focus on, it could be organizing, it could be just anything external that makes us feel like, okay, the coffee table looks all put together, the counters are cleaned off, the bathroom like drawer isn't crazy, I'm doing okay. It just makes us feel like it's not so bad. Now, Emily, she runs a tight ship. In order to keep her anxiety and mental health in check, she is very, very organized. And when she married Tom, she wanted to create a very calm environment. She introduced some pretty strict boundaries to her in-laws. So every visit has to be pre-approved with a phone call. Visits are short, and weekends with the grandkids, well, that rarely happens, but if it does happen, it would be once, maybe twice a month. For Karen, our mother-in-law, she's used to spontaneous visits, open door policy, and she feels like these boundaries just are like a direct rejection. And she often questions herself, like, does Emily even like me? Let me paint this picture for you even clearer so you can understand Karen's point of view. So she, last fall, she baked a lasagna and she showed up at the house unannounced, lasagna in hand, all proud, gonna like, you know, take care of her family. And Emily told her, like, you should have called first and shut the door. So now Karen just like steps off the front porch with tears in her eyes, just feeling like, I am an outsider. I'm a complete outsider in my son's life. Like, it was a terrible feeling for her. But this moment was about more than just a visit. It symbolized a shift in their family dynamics. Before we continue with Emily and Karen's story, let me quickly welcome any newbies to the podcast. My name is Jessica Miller, and I'm on a mission to bridge the gap between mother and daughter-in-laws so that they can build better relationships and make more memories together. After living decades doing boundaries all wrong, which also led to an unfortunate, tragic 2-year estrangement with my in-laws, now that I do understand boundaries, I just want to help other families be able to set healthy boundaries to avoid the dire, horrific consequences that come with estranging. So if this sounds interesting to you, make sure you hit that subscribe button and stick around. All right, back to understanding the shifts that are happening in family dynamics. To really grasp this, I think we have to look at the values, the main values from each generation. So for baby boomers, they value family time, loyalty, tradition, and just hierarchy in the family. And they often expect their children to drop everything for family gatherings and traditions. For Gen Xers, they value independence, work-life balance. They grew up in economic challenges. They often juggled career and family responsibilities, and they definitely looked forward to those golden years when they would finally be able to slow down and enjoy their adult children and grandbabies. Millennials, they prioritize work-life balance. They want to have purpose-driven work. They value experiences over material goods. They want to have self-actualization, so they're very like big supporters of mental health. They grew up with the internet and social media. They value space for family time and often feel pressure to do more from social media. I personally believe the biggest value shift that we've seen is between Gen Xers and millennials, because at this point, the biggest thing that perpetuates these shifts, I think it's social media. I mean, for Emily, she's weighed down by feeling overwhelmed. She's got a demanding career, she's got small children, and social media adds a lot of pressure. Her algorithm is filled with other moms testifying how their whole life changed once they set boundaries. It rid them of paralyzing anxiety and they have no more anxiety attacks. It's filled with experts vilifying in-laws for being too demanding and selfish because they want to see their grandkids, as well as picture-perfect families that have kids in sports, they shuttle them all around, they work full-time, they have perfect houses, perfect bodies. It's just a lot, because when she scrolls at night, and so she just lulls herself to sleep. So she just lulls herself to sleep with the blue light, watching, you know, people talk about boundaries, experts saying, like, your in-laws are terrible, or like they're causing you stress. And then she also sees like people just living perfect lives. And she often feels like, I need to do more. Our kids need to be in more activities. Like, I'm not doing enough, which is her old script from her childhood. Like, what if I'm never enough, right? So this just kind of keeps reaffirming her all the time. Like, you might not be enough. You might not be doing enough. And if you asked Emily and she was honest, after she puts her phone down at night, she often feels like crap. She just feels less than, she doesn't feel like she's doing enough. And then she drifts off to some sort of sleep. I think this is a moment that we all need to pause and just think about. Just think about the amount that comes at parents today. Like, it is so overwhelming. When my mom had kids, she would go to the library and look up a how-to book for parenting, or maybe she would ask her mom or her aunt. But like for us, we open this and as soon as the algorithm knows we're a parent, we are bombarded with ways that we need to parent or things we don't, like we can't do to our children, or we're going to screw them up forever or create a serial like murderer or whatever, you know, like it is so much. And then the pressure to make sure your kids are cultured and they get all these exposed to all these experiences. And I'm sorry, like club sports. It's a lot for parents, not only like time-wise, but all your resources. It's a huge time commitment. It's a financial commitment. It's a lot. So if you imagine all this is coming at them, you have to have all these things, got to have a perfect looking house with, you know, the new trending stuff. And then you have to look good. I mean, there's just so much coming at parents these days. So mother-in-laws that are Gen Xers or boomers, if you can just imagine all that pressure, then you think about, okay, when I call, because a lot of families nowadays, they don't even have family dinner together because there is no time. Like, I'll ask clients at my practice, so when's the last time you had family dinner? I don't know. We don't really do that. Like, we're just too busy. We're just shuttling all the time. That's so sad to me because I understand club sports or just extracurricular activities, it's good. But I also worry about how much is too much. And if you take away that core foundation of coming together at the dinner table, like every night, that ritual, I don't know what that does either. I don't know. But anyway, that's a side note. But the fact that families don't have time just as their core to get together and just really like marinate and get together and catch up. And then when in-laws or parents come to say, hey, can we come take some of that time? And they're like, oh my gosh, we don't even get 45 minutes together like at night. It's so intense and crazy and the pressure is enormous. And now you want to take that from me? It literally doesn't feel like a pleasurable visit probably for them. It feels like you're taking like the 45 minutes I've been looking forward to all week, because maybe that's the only 45 minutes they're going to get for the rest of the week. It's wild. I'm not saying it's healthy. I'm just trying to give you perspective of what I think millennials are actually going through and why it seems like they're just setting boundaries all over the place. I think they are so overextended. Like, there's just too much coming at them. And so they just feel like if I can just, you know, put up boundaries. And then when family just comes and says, hey, you know, like, you should care a little bit about spending time with your family. well, now they feel shame, right? But really, they're just in survival mode the whole time. Okay, I'll get off my soapbox. But let's think of Karen. So let's think of our mother-in-laws that are Gen Xers, boomers. She feels the sting of Emily's boundaries so deeply. Like, she was raised in a time where family was the central pillar. You did everything for family, and she longs for just spontaneous visits and unstructured family time. For her, these boundaries feel like she's just being kept away from her son and grandchildren. And honestly, this was just nothing like she imagined her retirement would look like. She envisioned zoo trips and picnics and beach days and sleepovers, like especially like midday sleepovers during the summer. And she just had all these ideas. None of it is coming to fruition. But during one particular family dinner, they finally had a breakthrough. Karen, she got emotional and she was trying not to cry. And she said, "Emily, do you even want us to be part of your life?" And Emily, she was already crying, and she said, "Karen, it is not about keeping you away. It's about protecting our family time and my mental health." And Emily continued by saying, "I need these boundaries to be the best wife and mom I can be." So hopefully you're starting to see the disconnect from where Karen is and Emily is, but you can start to empathize from both sides. In this moment, when Karen like looks across the dinner table and she sees Emily just so sad, like you can just tell she's exhausted, she starts to really understand, okay, maybe this has nothing to do with me. And she realizes like everything she expected about being a grandma, it was from her childhood. And it's a complete clash to the reality of Emily and Tom's life. Like, so for Emily, her need for strict boundaries is driven by her anxiety and desire for control to like manage that anxiety. And for Karen, she just wants spontaneity because that's the way she grew up in. But after that dinner, and after just seeing Emily break down, she just starts to feel the disconnect, and she starts to understand the reasons behind Emily's boundaries. Karen started to reflect on her own experiences as a young mother, like realizing that she had support, but the pressure that Emily is under, it was nothing like this for Emily. Like, it's very intensified for her. Like, the demands of modern life and the constant barrage of social media, like, Karen would never trade spots with Emily. Karen realizes that she kept up with the Joneses, while poor Emily, she has to keep up with millions of people online in their perfect highlight reels. Finally, there's a breakthrough, and Karen starts to recognize, yeah, these boundaries are actually, they're not about me. They're just about managing an overwhelming load, like on my daughter-in-law. I swear, I feel like some millennials feel sunburned by all the modern life demands. And they often feel as though family involvement is pressure more than pleasure. It just feels like we're drowning in these expectations. And at the end of the day, the answer truly is, you know, figuring out what our priorities are. But this is what it is. Like, we are comparing ourselves to other people online. We are feeling like we're not doing enough. We can all empathize with Emily. I can even tell you, when my kids were young, I would fall into the trap where we would be having a fine evening, and then I would look online and I would just scroll for a little bit and see three people or three different families post like perfect pumpkin patch photos. And I'd be like, "Oh my gosh, get in the car. We have to go do the pumpkin patch photo." Like, it's just stupid. But when you're younger, trust me, it gets better, ladies. Like, I love getting older. But when you're younger, there's just different brain chemistry. Our egos are bigger. Like, we're trying to keep up. But it gets a lot more relaxed the more confident you get, the older you get. So that is something to look forward to. But I remember that pressure when our kids were little and just trying to do all the things and keep up with the millions of Joneses, and I would never want to go back to that. But this disconnect between generations causes so many misunderstandings because we don't understand each other's side. Karen just wants to be a good grandma and experience the joy of life of like being around her grandkids, while Emily is already stretched way too thin, and she feels like these visits almost take away from her and not give anything to her. One evening, after Karen had been thinking long and hard about the way that she was able to parent and raise kids and the way Emily is having to be a mom and all the pressure, she decided, "I'm just gonna try something." And she went over unannounced and she showed up at the door, and Emily was just having a really, really hard night. She broke down immediately when she saw Karen on the front steps, and she just said, "Karen, I have to tell you that my boundaries are not to keep you away. Like, I love you. I'm just trying to keep my sanity intact." And this moment was a true turning point for them, because Karen just held Emily, and Emily truly felt just that nurturing love. And I would imagine she didn't get a lot of that if she grew up with conditional loving parents. After that very special night, they had several heart-to-heart conversations, and Emily and Karen started to begin to understand each other's perspectives more. And they agreed on certain, like, flexible schedules. During the summer, during breaks from school, holidays, Karen agreed that she's going to call before popping over, and that she's going to respect Emily's boundaries so that she is more of an asset than a burden. Emily also asked if Karen would help with some of the rides to the sporting events. They also set up a dinner bi-weekly where Karen and her husband would bring over dinner to Tom and Emily's place, so then they could all have a family dinner and Tom and Emily didn't have to do anything. So it was nice and easy, like easy cleanup, everything, and it was just good quality time twice a month. I have to tell you, I love that idea. Just think about setting up something like that with your in-laws or your parents, where they just bring something made. I mean, they could stop at the deli, they can do anything. They can bring dinner to you guys. You guys can have a family dinner, easy peasy cleanup. That would be, hopefully someone here is listening and they take that idea as well, because I really like that. So they worked together, got some new family traditions happening. They incorporated both Emily's need for structure and Karen's desire for closeness. It's not perfect, but I mean, it's real. So over time, they built a stronger, more respectful relationship that's definitely grounded in understanding and empathy. One holiday compromise came on Thanksgiving, where Karen, she loves to have a buffet style, as you can imagine, but Emily, she prefers to have structure and a sit-down meal. So Karen came over, set the table rather than doing the buffet style, took the kids on a morning adventure so then Tom and Emily could just have the morning to get ready for the big Thanksgiving fiesta. And then when Karen came back from the adventure, she went into the kitchen. She was helping Emily with the final preparations. And she said it just felt different. Like they're just closer. I just think that that's such a good example of really getting to know and understand each other. Karen really understood, if I want to be an asset and a support for my daughter-in-law, what would I do? Well, she really wants to have structure. So setting the table and having a non-buffet style dinner, like, that would be better. So I'll do that. But then she's going to be like, it's going to feel chaotic trying to get all the preparation. So I'll take the kids on an adventure, which that's what she loves. She wants to be spontaneous and the fun grandma. And Emily, instead of feeling like, I know I need to do everything on my own and have the control, she decided to, like, no, I'm going to get flexible. I'm going to allow Karen to come in. I'm going to allow her to support me and help me and help carry the load. And I just think that's so beautiful. And I wanted to share that last part with you. All right. So here are some key takeaways to Emily and Karen's journey. First of all, empathy. Understanding each other's needs and feelings was the first step towards the middle ground. Emily and Karen had to learn to see things from each other's perspectives in order to really start bridging that gap. That's where looking at the generational values, as well as their childhood and them as a person, their own personality traits and what they need, it's very insightful. And really, it took Karen stepping back and really looking at it from Emily's point of view to stop taking it personally. Like, her boundaries, Emily's boundaries, was not a personal attack. It wasn't even about Karen at all. It was just about keeping her own sanity. And once she stepped back and Emily felt understood, that gave Emily room to breathe and then realize, oh, Karen can be an asset. Like, she can help support me. Like, we can be more of a village here. Number two, communication. Open, honest, raw communication is crucial. Even the most challenging conflicts can be resolved when both sides are willing to come together and listen and share openly. Remember that tense dinner where Karen asked, like, if Emily even wanted them to be a part of their lives and why she kept them at arm's length? I mean, what a tough conversation, but also what a breakthrough. Karen was able to see Emily's emotion and vulnerability, and they both walked away from that dinner feeling more understood by the other person and having more empathy. And finally, number three, balance. Find a balance between personal boundaries and family closeness. And every family is different. The goal is to find ways to respect everyone's needs in the family. Millennial daughter-in-laws like Emily, and probably myself too, we are indeed changing the game, but it's not about trying to distance themselves from the family, but it's out of a need to protect our mental health and create an environment where we feel like we can thrive. So this shift might feel uncomfortable at first, especially to older generations that have different values, but it is an evolution that has happened in how we approach family relationships today. Now again, I don't know if we have our priorities right. All I know is that we are under a lot of pressure and we're doing the best we can. If you are a boomer or a Gen Xer, please take a second and just think again about what it would be like to raise a family in today's culture. I promise you, it's a lot. I believe the main root of this divide that millennials feel so overwhelmed and like their parents and in-laws, they just don't get it. It's because we are just too busy. We are overcommitted. We're running too much. We feel like we have to do more and we're never doing enough. So if you can come to us in a way where you're an asset and you're taking something off our plate, that would be a brilliant partnership. Ask to help to shuttle the kids, give the parents the night off, take them to the park so the parents can clean the house on a Saturday morning, just anything to help them out. And millennials, remember that Gen Xers and boomers, they longed for the day that they could finally slow down and just enjoy their adult children and their grandchildren. So make sure you remember that even though the experts say that all these club sports are necessary and the piano and the dance and all the things that we have to have our kids signed up for, just remember, time with grandma and grandpa carries an enormous benefit as well. Now look at Emily and Karen's story. Think about your own family dynamics. Are there boundaries that you need to set? Are there conversations you need to have? Remember, the goal isn't to create distance, but to foster a relationship where everyone feels respected and valued. Okay, friend, I hope you've enjoyed our little time together. I certainly appreciate you spending your time with me today. If you found this episode helpful, make sure you hit that like button. And if you found it really valuable, share it with one person you know. Until next time, friend, make sure you keep minding your boundaries.